everybody. You're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. We're doing a continuation of our online sales data project. Today we will do some formatting of date time and do multiple figures of ggplot2. As always, the code is in the link in the description below. You need to import libraries, knitter, markdown, tidyverse, ggplot2. Here's what our data look like. Of interest today is the country column, unit price, the invoice date for our manipulation, and quantity. We need to do some formatting of our invoice date. Since it's stored as a character currently, we take the formatting of how it's set up as month, day, year, hour, and minute, and we use the function called strptime, strip time. Here's what it looks like. From there, we use a function called POSIXCT, POSIXCT. And what you're doing is you're converting an object to a class. That's what this is right here. So then what we need to do is call our data that we just formatted here, and I'm extracting the hour, date, year, month, year, and then month year together. Now, I decided I wanted to order this so I could print it out and show you what it looks like real quick. I thought this would be helpful for the plots I'll show below, but I'll show you where there was a hiccup. Now, what I needed to do is convert my month from a numeric into the actual abbreviation name. There's a stored procedure that's called month.abb, so basically your month abbreviation. So I had to convert my character into a numeric for that column, if you see right here, and then run the name abbreviation, and then store it as a new column. I did as month underscore abbreviation, which is this right here. From there, we need to do a little processing. So what I did was I did a group by, and I called the country and the quantity from our data that is extracted. And here, if you remember, we took out all the canceled orders. We got rid of those. So that's what this data is now. I stored it as a data frame where I'm calling the new columns, country and quantity, and I'm doing an aggregate where I'm taking these two columns and I'm summing the quantity based on each individual country. And that's what you see here. So we have multiple rows of each country with a quantity, and I lumped them all together into one so we can do some plotting. For our first plot, I'm calling our ordered frequencies that I just stored above, and I have to call it reorder. And the reason I have to call this is because when you print this out, this right here will print out relative to the names in some kind of alphabetical order instead of by descending quantities. So then I said reorder country and quantity for my X, and Y is just my quantity. Then I call this geom bar, use a stat identity, and then I flip my coordinates. So that's why it's stacked like this. From there, I had to increase my text size. Using this parameter like this increases everything, all the text at once, instead of each individual layer. I wanted to get rid of all of my quantities which were stored as scientific notation, and that's what I did right here. And then I just called my label names and printed it off. You could also store these and save these plots, which I will do later for my final write-up for this paper. Okay, so here we are, and if you notice, it's kind of an issue because the dominating factor is the United Kingdom here, and it basically dwarfs any of our other data, so we can't get a real depiction of what's going on. So what I did was create a new graph and just exclude the country column of anything with United Kingdom and ran the same code again. This is just cut and paste with this new line here that was subsetting our data. And then you just call the new data frame here. And that's what this prints off. Then what we can do is say we just looked at countries by quantity sold of items. Let's look at currency. From there, we can do a plot instead of by quantity. We could look at by British pound. So basically the dollar amount that was sold through each country. We'll do the same thing here, but we need to get the dollar amounts, or British pounds, I should say. We need to create a new variable. So we need the total that was sold, which is the unit price times the quantity. And I'm using a general function that's called transform. It's taking my data and I'm creating a new column called total. From there, I'm doing a group by the country and our total, storing it as group sales, throwing that into a new data frame with the columns called country and totals, where I will now aggregate my total and the country and sum the values, just like we did above in the last example. So we're taking our country here. Each time you see each one of these countries, add it together. So that's what you end up here. And I just showed you visually, I just did an arrange and then descending order. So the plotting is pretty much the same, where you're doing your new data that you're throwing in there, and you're still doing the reorder again, but instead of quantity, you just throw in your totals here, and that's the only thing that's different. So as you notice here, it looks almost the same plot that we had. And you say, oh no, what's going on? Is there a mistake? Well, no. As an artifact, a lot of the items are around a dollar or 1 pound. So even though you start multiplying by quantities, that's why this plot looks very similar. So we need to negate this United Kingdom once again. So we'll do the same thing and subset our data and throw in the exact same information into our plot with our new subset data here. Just remember to put totals here instead of quantities and you're good to go. And it's the same thing for your sales. So you say, okay, this is very informative. What else can we do? We could look at sales by month, and this gets a little interesting. So I create a table from the column that I stored the dates for month abbreviations for all January, February, March, whatever. And I have to call this new vector here and put it in this order, because if you print it off without storing it as a factor here, it won't put it in the order that you think, even though the column name will be in the same order. Let's go to the top and I'll show you again to refresh real quick. Remember, I put these in order, right? And you say, well, what's going on then? Okay, well, let's go back. When you plot this, what happens is it'll plot it based on not the order of how the month actually goes, but it'll go on an alphabetical situation, which is an issue. So I create a table because I'm basically creating this table that allows me to get the frequencies by each month and store that. Then I'm converting it into a data frame and I'm calling the first column, which will get stored as var1, renaming it as month. I create this factor where I'm taking the month and my new ordered columns or label names and now the frequency, and just print this off as usual. And here we go. And it's in the correct order. So that's one thing to note. Then to plot by the day of the month, we do almost the same thing we did before, where we're taking the day of each month, storing it as a table. The table creates a frequency count for each day. Store that as a data frame. Your first column gets stored as variable 1. You rename it to what you would like. Your other column gets stored as a frequency. You call your data in where you have your x-axis, your y-axis, and your data. And then what I did here was create spacing between each one of these bars, and depending on how you set this up, the smaller this number goes, the smaller each one of these bars is, the larger it goes, the larger it is, okay? And then depending on how big your text is or how close they are together, you should do a rotation, and that's what I did here, which allows me to rotate the axes of my data. So you can see that by each day of the month, this is the frequency count or quantity that was sold, okay? I do the same thing for hourly sales, where it looks like the very exact same thing. Just repeat it, cut and paste for hours, restore a new variable, and plug and chug the same stuff that you do. You just change the X and this variable name, and everything else is the same. And then you just change this and this. So we see what's going on by hour. So obviously from lunchtime till 2 in the afternoon are the most sales, and people are going on the internet looking for things to purchase during the lunch break. We could do also plotting by the day of the week, but here you have to do another formatting. So since we had just the regular dates before, now you use this special operator for your formatting, and it'll print out Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, etc. If it's giving a date like 1/20/2010, it'll know where to find it. So then I store that as a table, get my frequency counts by each day, create a data frame as usual, then I call it just day of the week. Then I have to also do my factor situation so I get these in the correct order. And if you know, this company didn't have sales on Saturdays. And then everything else is the same, and you just plug in your level, which is your vector of Monday through Friday plus Sunday, and put everything else, and you're good to go. If you notice, we have everything put together correctly. Lastly, we have our month and year put together, and I have to do the same thing here where we need to call our factor. We need to call our factor and store that in here. And as you see, everything else once again is the same, except I needed to do an additional step here. I needed to call the tick marks and change the sizing of the tick marks. All right. And I also had to do a rotation again of my text because it was kind of jumbled around. All right. And you'll see that from December 2010 to December 2011 by month and year. Also, I could show you something real quick. I did this example last time where I created a range of prices from less than a dollar to a dollar, $1 to $3, $3 to $5, $5 to $10, greater than $10. All right. You could do that with nested if else statements where the second statement, instead of having less than a dollar, you threw another if else statement in there. And then at the end, you have the last two statements. If it's greater than 5 and less than 10, then it's 5 to 10. Otherwise, it's over 10. So then we take that price range column, create a table, get our frequencies, store it as a data frame, create a new labeled column name. Then we need to do a vector of our names so they're in order. Use the factor again, do everything else, as well as change our ticks and change the rotation of our labels. And there we go. And like I said before, the reason the quantity sold versus the prices of items that were sold by country look the same was because you have a lot of items that are between $1 and $3. If you demarcate this and put it, you'll notice that the mean of the items is around at $1.25, $1.50, something like that for the average price per item, or the mode. Might have been the mode. Can't remember. Nevertheless, went kind of fast because I wanted you to see multiple steps so you could do this at home. And pause the video and just copy the code and get an idea. Thank you for watching. I greatly appreciate it. And throw a like if you thought this was useful content. Please subscribe and turn on that notification bell. And leave a comment to tell me what you thought or how I could improve this channel for all of us. As always, I'll see you in the next video. Bye.